In this series of lectures on nucleic acid structure, I'll describe the forces that affect the structure of DNA and RNA, and we'll think about the stability and flexibility of DNA structures. You'll also learn about different structures that exist in RNA that we don't generally see in DNA. But to start, we will look at the different types of DNA double helices, which will involve talking a bit about the interactions that stabilize DNA structure. Now, I don't know if you've ever wondered why DNA forms a double helix in the first place. When you think about the structure of DNA in terms of polarity of the groups, you should soon realize that the phosphate and deoxyribose parts of a nucleotide are quite polar or hydrophilic. In contrast, the nitrogenous bases are fairly hydrophobic on the flat surfaces of the ring structures. They have polar hydrogen bonding groups, yes, but there are a lot of double bonds in the rings that form pi electron clouds on the flat surfaces of the bases. This means that the surfaces are hydrophobic, and it's energetically better to hide them from water if possible. In this diagram, the base pairs are represented by these rectangles, and the sugar phosphate backbones by the solid lines. If the DNA existed as two straight parallel strands, with the backbones straight between the bases, the length from one phosphate to the next is about 6 angstroms. But each base is 3.4 angstroms thick. That means there would be 2.6 angstroms of space in between the bases where water could enter and interact with the hydrophobic surfaces of the bases. Therefore, it would be better if the surfaces of the bases could come together to exclude water. The bases could come together in several ways. The most efficient way to cover the hydrophobic surfaces would seem to be to bring the one base pair straight down right on top of the other. The problem is that this would create steric clashes between the atoms of the sugar phosphate backbone. You could also imagine keeping the backbone straight and bringing the top base pair down toward the bottom one like this, but again, the backbone atoms could not be accommodated in this type of structure. The same is true if you rotated the backbone the other way. It turns out that you need to rotate one base pair relative to the other in order to bring the hydrophobic surfaces together while avoiding steric clashes among the backbone atoms. Twisting in the way shown is more energetically favorable than twisting in the other direction, giving rise to a right-handed helix when a series of bases are stacked on top of each other in this way. The most common double helix formed by DNA is called B-DNA, the structure of which is represented by these figures. Note that the structures as presented in diagrams like these are very regular and uniform, what you might call average or ideal structures. I'll talk about deviations from the average structure in another video, but for now, just understand the basic properties of the B-DNA double helix. It is anti-parallel and right-handed. I do expect you to be able to identify whether helix is right-handed or left-handed just by looking at it. The B-DNA double helix has 10 base pairs per turn, with a length of 3.4 nanometers per turn, and a width of 2.4 nanometers. The bases are not exactly perpendicular to the helical axis, but have a slight tilt, 1.2 degrees on average. And there's an average propeller twist of 16 degrees. I'll describe what this means in a later video. You are responsible for knowing the facts in the red boxes. Note also that the double helix has a major groove and a minor groove. There's more space between the DNA backbones on the major groove side than on the minor groove side. This is because of the way the sugar phosphate backbones are positioned relative to the bases. So you might be able to see from this diagram here on the right. Another form of DNA in which the DNA is less hydrated is A-DNA. Like B-DNA, this type of DNA is right-handed, but if we look down the helical axis, we can see that the bases pair with each other away from the center of the helix and toward the edge. This makes the minor groove much more shallow than in B-DNA and the major groove much deeper. So in the diagram on the left, the edges of the bases in the major groove are sort of in the center of the double helix. The bases are tilted much more than in a B-DNA double helix, and there are 11 base pairs per turn. The diameter of the A-DNA double helix is wider than that of the B-DNA helix. ADNA is not as common as BDNA in vivo, so I don't want you to remember the parameters, except that it's right-handed and has 11 base pairs per turn. I will say that RNA double helices, or DNA-RNA hybrid helices, have structures that more resemble ADNA than BDNA. And now for something completely different, zDNA can occur in stretches of DNA with alternating purine-pyrimidine bases along one strand. In this form, the purine bases rotate 180 degrees along the N-glycosidic bond, which is called the chi bond, as I'll describe in another video. Basically, the purine flips to be sort of over top of the deoxyribose sugar, but it can still base pair with the corresponding pyrimidine on the other strand. When an entire stretch of purines flips in this way, a left-handed double helix results, which we call zDNA. The major groove of zDNA is shallower than the minor groove, and the helix has 12 base pairs per turn. As for the ADNA double helix, I just want you to remember the handedness of the helix and the number of base pairs per turn. Unless specifically noted, anytime I'm talking about DNA double helix in this course, you can assume I'm talking about BDNA, since it is the most common type of DNA structure found in cells. So in the next video, I'll go into more detail about the forces that stabilize these helical structures.